Okay, so I think it's visible, the diagram. That was, this is actually the start, and the only image that I will have is this diagram that started in time. And why it's important, because when it was constructed, let's say in the last years, it came out from my work onto the question of Europe, Eastern Europe and West Europe, but even more on the question of memory and history and the changes that we are witnessing in the last decades. First, it was kind of mostly functioning almost like a kind of a projection or imagination, especially because at the moment, some years ago, when it was realized, it focused a lot on fascism. And fascism practically was seen as a historical phenomenon. But today, we see very clearly that the questions that are posed and elements that are organizing the European space in terms of fascization, new types of fascisms coming back and organizing the social space. So this diagram suddenly started really to be very present and also showing different histories behind. So it's not true that Eastern Europe is only fascistic. Also the Western Europe, if we can use these terms, and I will talk a little bit, it's also fascistic, but the fascisms differs regarding certain historical backgrounds. So what I want to do is first to thank Magdalena and Agata for this invitation. I'm very pleased, and I want to sketch in this short time some of the possible theses or consequences, specifically also to a very precise moment that Edith point out how to think the decolonial and where we stand in all these relations. Also, I would like to say that one of my focus in this diagram and what I want to talk but not really describe is all centered on the question of antagonism. So not so much narratives, but antagonisms that I will focus on three elements. One will be the antagonism of race and the processes of racialization that are very present in global capitalism. So structural racism, but more than just stereotypes, racialization as almost a terminal way of discrimination and works and also dislocate with class and gender. Second is the question of the human, because it's more than just thinking about Eastern Europeans or Western Europeans, though Western Europeans actually organize the space, this re-Westernization, but the human in term in simply in the question where we stand now in Europe when we see the refugee crisis that was also brought, and where it's actually this what we cry over our humanities, in which relation, but how this humanity actually even more stands and relates to another category that I think define radically the new geography, if we can use this word new, and this is citizenship. So we don't talk anymore about citizens and second and third grade citizens that were a story, at least what was possible to hear these days, coming out our secondary position. We are not equal, but actually the new antagonism between citizens and non-citizens. That is the key element of reorganization of the European space, if we talk about Europe, and we have to talk about Europe. And the third element will be definitely the question of labor and capital. And all these three are implying different ways of thinking epistemology, and also to think these ideological structures and the way from which we talk when we talk about contemporary art, or we talk about these art historical ways of entering the space of Europe. Also, maybe the title, the post Socialist and post-colonial conditions could be maybe a relief, I thought, for some of my colleagues. They say, super, she will not talk anymore about our space, so we can do our lobbies and work on without problems, because colonialism has nothing to do with us. But I will say that practically this question of post-socialist and post-colonial conditions, and the third element that is also part of the whole section, decolonial, they actually ask and imply that we have to really think what is the space of Europe today, where this Europe and especially European Union stands. I want to show in difference to such possible thinking that this has nothing to do with us, that this provincial, racist, colonial, and anti-Semite space of the European Union, and here are Germany, Austria, Slovenia, and Poland, all, and many others, because the list is too long, practically, this space needs a radical new approach, and I will call this approach actually an approach that speaks and try to rethink the space for a migrant, transfeminist, and I will call this political decolonial approach, because decolonial, it, as it stands, it's too fluctuating, but the political stance means really to rethink the space from where we talk. And to show how this implies into the space of Europe, it's possible already and all the time to go back to different genealogies. I think that exist several lines of how the space of Europe is perceived, and this way it's not just some kind of narratives, but this way of genealogies that these sentences that are uttered from a specific point of view of how to perceive Europe practically gives us also this ideological framework from which we enter the space. So, for example, I can say immediately, in order to think about the totalizing concept of Europe and disentangle this totalizing concept, that Eastern Europe is the former of Europe. This idea of Eastern Europe as the former practically states us not in space, but in time. That is very correct to have this time component and force us to think Eastern Europe as something backward. And this is all the time coming up with narratives, how to actually show it was not like this, but the whole formulation of this former of Europe, that now it's part of Europe, so this before being out and now being actually inside, but the Europe actually moved. It moved not anymore in this differentiation East and West, but it moved actually to another level. So we are always in a certain way, if we think about Eastern Europe as a concept, not just a pure geography, but as a concept of condition and work and also to ideology and to thinking and so on, working. It's something that is always out of time, but actually situated because of this out very much in time. Even more exist two other very important statements about these genealogies that are always political, and one was stated in 2008 already, and it's important, it was stated when it was the eve of the financial crisis. And this financial crisis actually made a completely disentanglement. I mean, the capitalism showed a very big intensity and a face of absolute disbalance that was part of the way how capitalism functions, but in the most purest way. And at that point in 2008, Natasha Velikonia, that declared herself as lesbian, that is important for her to state a lesbian position and activist from Slovenia, she stated, Europe is boring. Boring in terms that always the same questions are appearing while the actual world changes in front of us, because it's going back to these myths of how we were, what was going on and so on. But what is interesting is that in 2010, another theoretician, Etienne Balibar, said another announcement, and this announcement is interesting and important for us because he said Europe is dead. And this was in 2010. So, but then, importantly, showing how this Europe changed in 2018, this means this year, in July, in Netherlands, in Amsterdam, it was the 11th annual summer school on Black Europe. So Europe already is not Europe. Black Europe, it's actually a category of this appropriation, but it's not just appropriation, it's actually contextualization of the position of those migrants, minorities, post-colonial subjects. They rethink the whole space and they give a damn to East Europe or West Europe. They talk about Black Europe, and the title of this 11th annual summer school, so it's lasting for 11 years, was Interrogating Citizenship, Race, and Ethnic Relations. So citizenship in front of what we have, it's one of the key categories, especially citizenship, non-citizenship. And what they actually uttered in difference to the stories and the possibility to think of Eastern Europe being something former of Europe, they said, Black Europe is still persistently today produced as the other of Europe. So in this way, the categorization and these stories change radically in the way how we think, and also brings what I say a very important moment, and this moment is the question of racialization. Why I want to emphasize this? Because looking back in the 90s, and we have to go back, but back in terms of genealogies and thinking all these changes, former Eastern Europe, a former Western Europe that I will come, what this means. In these changes, the 90s were presented after the fall of the Berlin Wall as one of these discontinuities, but it was actually after the Cold War. It was shown as kind of a blossoming of identity politics. Looking now back, we can actually see that many of the way how the space were constructed was not just a cultural phenomena, though everything was presented as being cultural, while the antagonism of labor, the antagonism of class, the antagonism of disbalance in the labor-capital relation was absolutely outside. And I dare to say that what we had as a blossoming of identity politics was actually a process of racialization. It was a cultural racism that actually was functioning as a classificatory matrix that sustained a monopoly on a violent classification, on a violent bordering, what are these positions, what and who actually will live, and who and how will actually be put or peripheralized or absolutely outside of the possibility to work and also to be part of the European space. And we see this very palpably in these days because of other processes that I will tackle, but very, very shortly and very soon. So practically, it's possible to see that at that point, from this what could be perceived as global capitalism, we see that power, that the relations to capital, power and labor, and also as one of the main relations, started to organize another space of Europe. And I will say a Europe where it's not just the question of Eastern and West populations of part, but also actually producing of new categories. And this is superfluous population that were practically also, we see them because we have this process of refugees, and this is something that is really pressing on our way, how we categorize, how we write, how we actually enter the sphere, and we in a certain way raise the question of political subjectivities. But also what is more important is that we saw the capital militarization and rampant deprivation of spaces all around Europe, and in Europe also on the borders, and what is important, a new re-westernization, I will say, or occidentalization of the white matrix of power. So this whiteness, this regime of whiteness, it's not strange that actually they it was the conference on Black Europe, and it's lasting because the white matrix of power is present in this space, and we cannot take ourselves outside of this, because though historically we said no, we were colonized, it is a question to think very much what this means and who and on under which condition, still the white regime of powers and the enlargement of Europe went in this case, because actually it went to embrace former Eastern Europe, especially this Christian world, in order to reaffirm the power of the white and also diminish the what was seen and is still seen as a problem of those who are not enough civilized, pressing with other religions and entering the European space. So practically, what I think is important when we talk about Europe is actually to tackle the apartheid politics of the European Union that is practically connected mostly to this re-westernization and re-occidentalization, and we are taking part because through all these questions of being not the other, trying to enter the space, but also it's important to emphasize these elements of antagonism. So now I'm coming to the point why it's actually important to have this decoloniality. How to think about this decolonial moment in relation also to post-colonial and post-socialist. One element that I found very productive for the understanding of the whole century that we speak, and this is the 20th century, mostly all our discourses, 60s, 70s, 80s, are actually about the question of modernity. And what is important is that the decolonial thought or turn or horizon that came very soon, very early, I mean, something new, practically was proposed as a whole way of thinking in the 2000s. So this is not decolonization that is going on after the Second World War. It's not post-colonialism that is actually the outcome of the post-colonial subjectivities that with right come to Europe, and actually because they are all coming from the colonies and they try to figure out where is the place, because the places from where they are coming, they are already a part of the primal or enlarged accumulation of Western world. The wealth is coming from there. So the decolonial in 2000 it's also an empowering of the Latin America. But what is important is that they, in their thoughts, bring a small engine. I will call this a coyote. I like this, what Donna Haraway talk about the coyote, but this is not the coyote of Joseph Beuys. It has nothing to do with this. So just to be clear, Donna Haraway talk about the coyote actually as gendered, as actually a position outside of this masculine hegemonic power. So what they pose, the decolonial, they talk about the colonial matrix of power. And this matrix of power, the power in itself is important in the way because the colonial matrix of power resides onto a very subtle differentiation. The statement is no modernity without coloniality. Doesn't exist. And we, when we talk about the 20th century, we talk about actually modernity. We talk about a much wider space of modernity, also because the Western modernity, we can say, was reappropriated, I will say not reappropriated or just repeated in the East, but was also readjust. It was, so to say, made radically raw on certain level, and I think this was our power. It was also copied, and in this copy elements, many distortion happened, and this distortion produced many important things. So this decoloniality, coloniality, modernity, that is central for the decolonial thought, is also important for us because allows to think differently the previous century, and even more, you can ask yourself, so what we do in the 21st century? And I think the global capitalism actually, even one moment is important, when it's the decolonial that say it's no modernity without coloniality, it says practically that coloniality is the darker side of modernity. So this darker side of modernity is like the other side. But I will say, for us, and going back to this diagram, in order to understand and also to bring back histories that are much larger, it's that the global capitalism has its darker side. And this darker side is not in the European context specifically, it's actually fascism. So this element is actually some differentiation between the 20th century and the 21st century. And this fascism, it's not the historical fascism, though has ties to the fascism, historical fascism, but as every term in the 21st century has this additional moment. And I would like actually to emphasize now how this function, and it's how actually shows also the what Edith was saying, how to think about this invigorated nationalism, how to think about the space of a nation state that we talk about, Czech, Poland, Slovenia, and so on. But there we see practically processes of unbelievable discrimination, seclusion, and so on. So it's actually two types of fascism that are at work. One is the one who stays for the nation states of former Eastern Europe, and this is actually what is called turbo fascism. And it's called going on with this turbo realism and the turbo expedient way of entering the whole idea and how actually global capitalism function. There was no, so to say, 200 years of implementation of capitalism in the whole brutality, but the brutality was synthesized in the last 20 years. While, as I said, the Western world practically cannot say and look on that side saying the fascism is there. It's a specific way of fascism, and I would like to emphasize that for the 21st century, what we have is this postmodern fascism that is working very well with the world states, because what we have from the colonial state, France, Germany, Britain, and so on, it's a new formation, especially US. It's the war state. It's not anymore the nation state. The nation state is reserved for Eastern Europe. There we work on this construction of localities, of our specificities, while the war state is something that is actually this verticality that works with postmodern fascism, and you can read very clearly in which way this social body is presented with all this production of the other and so on and so. So just to come to the conclusion, because I think the time is pressing, I want to emphasize in regard to this, that if we think about the new geography, if this term is possible to be used, definitely is not about space, but is about the implementation of, as I said, labor and capital, race, racialization, and even more this question of citizenship that reorganized the space. And I see actually this new space based on four points that are violent processes. The first one is that we get two modes of life. So if we talk about the Cold War and post-Cold War, we had in the West this biopolitics. But today we have two different ways of life, and this is not necrophilia, because I have necrophilia is a pure Western concept. They, you know, you can have necrophilia because it's connected with the fascism, but also with the fetish way of this Eros and Thanatos. No, it's biopolitics and necropolitics. And biopolitics is simply the world in the time of the Cold War, making a welfare state and having no idea what's going on, where is the iron curtain. But necropolitics is something else. Necropolitics is actually in implementing the war machine that we see very palpably all around by the war states in Middle East, in Africa, and so on, where people, and more also in Europe, are just made in division onto two prepositions. One is who should live, and the other is who must die. And this who must die, we see very clearly, and we absolutely don't care, because we watch this for 3 minutes on the television and we absolutely think this has nothing to do with us, but actually has to do, because it's connected with these processes of fascization and also with this whole history that is in the back and that is actually coming out very palpably, though people say don't talk about anti-Semitism, don't talk about these things, this is actually working and is present in the space. So this is one, biopolitics, necropolitics, and this is then producing this former Eastern Europe without the quotation mark, and former Western Europe, because former Western Europe is just a spectral attitude that I'm writing in this last part, where it's actually said how this repetition function, it's evacuate actually antagonisms and responsibles. Then it's the second point is really connected with financialization, dispossession, and also with this process of repetition of the labor capital relation. And yesterday was a very good point brought to rethink this space, in which way? Because we see the targeting not even more of the subjects or political subjects that many of the talks wanted to bring, what is the political subjectivity, but definitely on the question of the human. The processes of financialization, they really open a whole set of the darker side, and this is dehumanization. So when we talk about humanity, we have always to think about this darker side. Then the next very important point is the war that is becoming the enduring war as one of the main relations that we see how the global world is actually put working and reworking all the time. And finally is the question of race and citizenship that I think that has to be connected. In which way? Because going back to this biopolitics and necropolitics, this differentiation, some live still in some welfare states and others are actually already, for them is decided they should not live. They have no place anymore here. But in that relation, we also see that our universal modernist topics, like notions, like citizenship, also change radically. In which way? Accordingly to many research, practically in the last year, we have a new format of citizenship. And this citizenship is actually necropolitical citizenship. It started in 2013, so it's not necrophilia, it's necropolitical citizenship. In which way? In 2013, when all this big idea of first the bad moral conscience of the West that capitalize the whole last 50 years on human rights, started to just freak out because 500 refugees drowned in one day, in one night near Lampedusa. And what happened in that moment? In that moment, Italian government, and this actually EU, declared these 500 people are Italian citizens. And everything what they did coming in Europe, it's actually this idea to get the citizenship in order to actually survive and be here. But they got this only when they died. In that moment, they were actually declared Italian citizens. So in this way, this classification between, if we have a necropolitical citizenship, this also applied to biopolitical citizens that we are. And that means this can actually also vanish very soon because it's not just this universal notion of our place or for our possibility to travel, to go, but actually can be taken back. That was never a case in the past when the nation state were functioning. So this question of race and citizenship actually make a differentiation. White citizens and other, black European citizens, Chicanas, Asian minorities, and definitely non-citizens. So non-citizenship as a new category that is not just a description, but is actually something that asks to rethink the whole space of Europe and also to rethink, so to say, these questions of political subjectivities that is coming out and is actually just localized but has to have inside the whole story. So the end is that practically the question is how this decolonial can and why it's important besides the colonial matrix. It's paradoxical that in this moment, in 2018, they started to have a special series in US, and this re-westernization is super important because we cannot go out of the occidentalization of the whole space of epistemology. So in Duke University, they actually started very soon because if you think that 2000 was the beginning of decoloniality, with a new series of books called On Decoloniality. What is important for this own decoloniality is that they actually made, they want to develop the decolonial engagement with Eastern Europe. besides South America, then South Africa, and many different elements of feminism and so on, also post-Soviet analysis. And for us, for me, one of the most important questions that is posed is how this decolonial turn, besides this differentiation that I really think is central, 20th century, 21st century, where we stand, and if they can work with this, because this is not part of the agenda, so how they will include Eastern Europe, how we actually go into this relation, because, and I finish with this, exists two ways of analysis. One analysis on which some decolonial theoreticians stays, they said it's no possible to use the master tools to dismantle the master house. Simply to say, the point is absolutely cut with what was produced also in the European thoughts, but also in the Eastern European thoughts. This is one strand that I'm very questionable. And the other is actually that was proposed by other theoretician. And this is actually the possibility to work with the master tool. But why? In which way? To construct alternatives in terms actually to construct a possibility first to denude the master discourse and to also do something more important, include in this way of how we talk about history, memory, geography, actually to include communities and individuals and social activities that are absolutely yet not part of the discourse that we have. So that means to enlarge the artistic research with the social and political of this moment. And in this way, I think maybe this decolonial, if it will go in this direction, that is a question to see, can really work and coincide or make a difference to what we think about the Eastern European space. Thank you.
Thank you very much.